I grew up hunting and fishing, and that spawned a love for wildlife and what, you know, just wildlife ecology in general, and my love for the outdoors. And that has led me down the path to get multiple degrees in wildlife ecology and forestry, and ultimately led me to the position I'm in now. It was which is an associate professor at the University of Florida in the Wildlife Ecology and Conservation Department. It started with the Florida Fish and Wildlife Commission. They wanted to evaluate productivity and also look at key aspects of populations like the timing of nesting and hen survival, and also the timing of gobbling as it relates to nesting and the hunting season date start dates, which in Florida, we have an early season, South Florida, and then we have a, you know, dividing line, and then we have the north season, which starts a little bit later. In this project, we are capturing wild turkey hens in particular in both regions. So we have we'll have data on when hens nest and gobbling as it relates to the hunting season dates. Another aspect of the study that became interesting and of interest just in general for wild turkeys is related to how hunting might influence gobbling chronology. And we were able to add a component to the project to evaluate that specific idea. And in that part of the project, we have ARUs, two of the areas which were trapping turkeys and putting tags on them, but also an additional several areas that are paired, where we have one area that's hunted and a paired area nearby that is unhunted. So we can get a really good idea of how hunting is influencing gobbling as we're hearing it through these recording units. Yeah, you know, we have a lot of data from many states now where we have tracked gobbling. Almost all of that data has come from hunted populations. And this design will allow us to take a step back and say, okay, this is what the gobbling looks like chronologically and the, you know, intensity wise in hunted populations. How do what is data look like when it's unhunted? And in the design that we have, it's called a before after control impact design, because we have two areas that we're monitoring gobbling for about a month, and then one of the areas initiates hunting because you have hunting, the season date start, and the other population remains unhunted. So you can even see, once hunting starts, do we see some kind of shift in gobbling? And that really, it's expected that there would be some influence of hunting because males are being targeted during the hunting process, but that really is allowing us to understand what we've been measuring in many areas, you know, because we're only looking at hunted populations. Now we can understand what, if anything, the impact of that hunting has been on what we've been observing. So other states have taken measures to change season structures and season dates, and there's interest in that because of the wild turkey decline as one of the potential measures to help correct issues. And that's what we're gathering data here to see. You know, Florida has not altered season, and they're not planning to, but instead they're funding this work to evaluate the effects of hunting, and that will ultimately inform decision making down the road, which is should be commended for the state agency, because they're collecting data to try to make informed decisions based on research. We will be capturing turkeys and fitting them with the GPS transmitter, And not only does that transmitter relocate the turkey over and over again via GPS, the other thing is it allows us to check on the status of the bird. And if one, you know, if the transmitter stops moving for a set amount of time, then it will send us a mortality signal. So the signal changes and we know that we need to go check on the bird. That can happen for multiple reasons. It doesn't necessarily mean that the turkey is dead. For instance, the tag could come off, or sometimes a hen is sitting on a nest and she's not moving much. And, you know, those tags could give us a false signal, but ultimately it allows us to quantify what proportion of the turkeys, or what's the probability that, that, you know, an adult turkey dies. And if we do have turkeys die, we can try to evaluate what caused the death. So was it predation or some other factor in the environment? You know, sometimes things happen to turkeys that you can't tell, but many of the times we have pretty good field evidence because of this technology that we can actually determine the probable cause of death. So far, I think our data, we have a small sample size at this point, but our data indicate that those same causes of mortality for hens and toms are pretty consistent with what other studies have seen. That, you know, there are predation events, and then there are some other, you know, factors that might be affecting survival as well. I think it's a little bit early to tell what's going to be the dominating cause of mortality, but you know, even in a healthy population, hens succumb to various factors. You know, death is a part of how populations function. So I think that's one thing that's important for people to realize, that, you know, even in a really healthy growing population, you still have animals die, and some are killed by predators, some are killed by elements, some are killed by disease. And I just don't know yet what the relative importance of those factors here, but pretty consistently across the range, males usually the leading cause of mortality is hunters. I will say, based on the vital rates, we haven't, so far, we haven't seen anything that is outside of the normal bounds of what we see on finished research projects and other species. But, you know, with the Osceolas being restricted to a pretty small area in Peninsular Florida, you know, we need to evaluate that specific population and subspecies. And the last time that, you know, we've had a project like this, it is, you know, been a couple of decades ago. So even if we just show that the vital rates are the same as everywhere else, that's important information, because we, you know, we come back to the population and have to check up on it, over time to make sure it stays healthy. I think Florida is a unique, and the Osceola subspecies in particular, is a unique situation. You know, there are a lot of things changing that are affecting wildlife, and, you know, those things are affecting turkeys. We have land use changes, you know, growing human populations. A lot of things have been changing, and Florida has a really interesting situation that allows us to really well understand how some of those changes might affect turkeys. You know, they're already in a restricted range. Florida's human population is growing fairly quickly. And we also have some really awesome initiatives in Florida, like the Florida Wildlife Corridor, that can allow us to look at broader scale issues like habitat connectivity. And, you know, we have a really unique situation here in Florida to understand all of those competing pressures on turkey populations, and the fact that they're highly sought after by people within and outside the state. So even the hunting aspect, But, you know, putting those together and then having an initiative like the Wildlife Corridor Project to understand the importance of connectivity and habitat, I think is pretty unique. We have a unique contribution to, you know, to provide there, you know, that we can show that habitat connectivity is, or what the relative importance of that factor is, so, since we have so many pressures on habitat.